Man, this weather couldn't be more perfect. Halloween is upon.
Gotcha!
Man.
Ah, Halloween. The best day of the year, second only to April Fool's. Nothing can top this. Huh? Who's there? I don't recognize that whistle.
Hello? Wow, what a way to welcome a guest.
Help! Help! The Quintrell 311 is after me! Run for your life!
Hey, stop! Ben, what is your problem?
It's the Clinchfield curves. She's from Tidewater, Pennsylvania. I met her in Chicago some time ago.
And what is she doing here?
I heard Mr. Evans brought her for the Halloween event. Something to do with that stupid Clinchfield curse legend.
Oh, hey sir. What's up?
Yeah, I was just about to head my way to Winslow.
Guys, I've got some bad news. Ben was screwing around AGAIN and crashed into Lancelin on the switch outside the station. So I'm afraid you're all stuck here for a while. Oh, come on!
Are you kidding me?
Some of us have places to be?
Yeah, and some of the residents here prefer the peace and quiet disturbed.
Georgia, I think he's referring to us.
At least be thankful you guys have a shed.
Well, he's right. We should be happy I have a home at least.
Most of us.
Now if you excuse me, I'm gonna talk to Ben. Ugh, now that's just great. We're stuck. Mainly without Ben.
You're not far off from him, attitude-wise.
Oh, shut up!
Now, guys, let's not spend the night bickering. How about we do something less ugly to pass the time?
Well, it is October, so a Halloween story would be perfect.
Well, anyone here have a good story?
What about that Canadian mountain type in Pennsylvania? No, sorry, it's a Confederation, please.
Perhaps that powerful tank engine in Colorado?
Or maybe that Berkshire haunting in Michigan?
Oh! I got a good one!
It better not be that Clinchfield Tales, because that's not scary.
Nor is it even original.
You don't know a good story if it smacked you in the face.
Well, maybe I do.
Alright, let's begin with Cobot's story.
Are you serious?
Quiet. Oh, gotta clear out the old smoke box. God. Now, does anyone remember those promotional films railroads made back in the 30s? Well, not all of the footage filmed was used, and some end up stored in the archives. One interesting case is a film made by Santa Fe. At first, there doesn't appear to be anything special about it. After all, it's just a wood-burning 10-wheeler passing by. Nothing more. There were a few odd things about it, though. The locomotive wasn't pulling anything, there were no coaches, no boxcars, hell, not even a caboose. It was just the locomotive. The scenery was a farmland that looked like, say, Missouri or Kansas. The locomotive would whistle at the 20-second mark before the film cut to black. Everyone believes that's how it ended. Or at least that's what Santa Fe wants you to believe. One day, sometime around 1936, a shopping mall theater was supposed to screen another promotional film made by Santa Fe. There were only a handful in the audience unlucky to see what played instead. The film started with a countdown before flickering to black. Flickered again, the screen displayed the footage I was talking about. It was the same, except there were a few differences. The film was accompanied by some unnerving music, which sounded like a piano playing a horror movie tune. Two-minute mark, the film continued going where it should have ended and changed angle. In the second shot, the music abruptly stopped when the telltale sound of a piano being smashed by a sledgehammer sounded. By the fourth shot, the tenwheeler began to slowly accelerate, and the sky above turned dark. seventh shot, the landscape was pure hell beyond your worst nightmares, and the audio in the background began to turn into inhumane screams, which were soon joined by the crowds in their seats. At the 12th shot, the film abruptly flickered to a presented by the Santa Fe Railway title card. It ended right then and...
BORING!
Anyways, a police investigation took place shortly after. They searched a projection room, but the only film reel that was found was the one that was intended to play. However, it was all burnt out when they tried to roll it. Things got weirder the following morning. The 10-wheeler featured was reported missing by the locomotive crews. There was no leads to its whereabouts, and no results came from the searches. Santa Fe has refused to comment on the incident ever since.
Gee, it sure is boring around here!
As I was saying, believe it or not, that wasn't the only time the film was seen. In 1962, late-night viewers reported seeing a similar film on ABC. A commonly described difference was that the several unnerving faces flashed on the screen. No one knows if it was the same film, but maybe it's because no one wants to find out. And that, my friends, is the
end. Boring! Again!
Okay, if you're done interrupting, I'd like to close my story on a spooky note. The end.
I don't think I'm gonna sleep tonight.
Oh, quit being such a wuss, Mitchell. Who would be scared of an old film reel?
You sure you're not covering up the fact that you were actually scared?
No, I'm definitely sleeping tonight. Okay, let's highball. Ah! Scary 10-wheeler! And away we go. Ugh! Scary 10-wheeler!
Oh, I'm sure.
If you're done, come on. I got a story, too. And if you start a haunted movie with Scary, try a haunted video game.
Sheldon, we don't play video games.
Who's telling the story here?
You.
Good! Now, anyway... Are any of you guys familiar with the recently released Commodore 64?
No, because I'm a locomotive, and I can't even hold
it. As I was saying... That computer is very popular, and my engineer happens to own one. He's also a pro with other consoles like the Atari 2600 and the Intellivision. These two factors combined lead us to the beginning of my story. My engineer was walking home from work one night when he saw something on his doorstep. It was a Commodore 64 floppy disk with a note attached to it. It said the following.
Frank, I need you to destroy this godforsaken thing. I would do it myself, but you know I find it a chore to even change the channel. So that's why I so desperately need you to do it. Signed, Jeremy.
My engineer was of course pissed off at being forced to do something by that lazy couch potato of a neighbor and decided to do the opposite.
What a lazy bastard. He wants me to destroy it? Screw him, I'll just play it.
So he went home and immediately started up his computer. He placed the disc in this Commodore 1541 and turned on the game. After typing down the key code provided on the disc, a title card appeared. Feeling even more irritated that someone would overreact over just a train game, baby, he pressed start. After the game loaded, it went to the first cutscene at a locomotive shed. However, it just stayed there. It was just that one shot, and there wasn't any sound either. It stayed there for about 30 seconds. He was about to turn the game off when it cut to the gameplay.
Wow. This is quite late in the game.
This time, it showed the tank engine at a station, with the text box saying, "Good job, you were right on time." But the level didn't fade out. It was as if it wasn't over. so we moved the tank engine forward out of curiosity. It would keep going for about 15 seconds before static enveloped in the screen. Strangely, there was video in the static. It appeared to be a distorted video of the tank engine getting scrapped. Static faded back to the level. This time, everything was on fire and the tank engine was chasing after another one. Feeling that something wasn't right, he slowed the former down, losing the other one. Suddenly, the most horrifying image appeared. It was that black tank engine. The tank engine became hyper-realistic, its headlight turned red, and the number 666 appeared on its side tanks. The graphic design was of much higher quality than what the Commodore 64 was capable of, and there was some text above it.
Be real, he doesn't scare me.
Static appeared for a split second before returning to that same image, with some different text.
Ah, so you do want to play hardball. How about this? You make Planet 9 from outer space look like Nosferatu.
It cut back to the same shed from the beginning. This time, the background looked like hell. There were many locomotive parts scattered around, the sky was black, and fire could be seen in the distance. The music was the title screen music, only it was distorted and plain at first. The tank engine was standing in the middle of the screen. After that, the computer exploded.
God damn it! I just got that computer!
Do you want to play again? God has abandoned you. The dead have risen. Hail Satan, you shall all die!
The end. Ha 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 ha!
Okay, suddenly, I have a new appreciation for Cabot's story. I mean, that was just ridiculous. What's so scary about a toy train?
Connor, for once, I actually agree with you.
Even Timothy the ghost train was scarier than that.
Boy, are you serious now?
Not if you know a good story so it smacks you in the face!
I know a good story.
Oh yeah? Well, why don't you put your money where your mouth is, Connor?
You know what? I will. Time ago, on a narrow gauge railway somewhere in Wales, stood a small yard where a little locomotive worked. The place was quiet and empty. The engine was usually alone. One night, she hoped she was.
It's that blasted noise again.
Hello? Is anyone there?
Hi! Who is this?
Gwen, of the artist who does Corey.
Oh, well, you see, I'm lost, and I'm low on call. Can you help guide me to your yard?
Well, I can guide you to the junction first. Tell me where you are.
Where I am.
Let me check the map. Do you see any landmarks?
I see a lake.
Okay, proceed south down the line to our widest junction. Then take a left turn. Continue going until you see some floodlights. Those mark where the quarry is.
Thank you. This is well appreciated. I gotta go.
Something didn't sound right about that engine.
Even by train standards, that voice just didn't sound human.
Hello.
Oh, hello, Jeffrey. Where are you off to?
Just retiring for the night. What I want to be out here with? Whatever is making that horrible noise.
Any explanation you can come up with?
There are many. But most common one I can recall is the goat train.
The goat train? What on earth is that?
Oh, wouldn't you like to know?
Wait a minute! A story in a story?
Byron!
I'm trying to tell a story here.
All right.
Anyway, the GOAT train is a supernatural engine reported on various narrow gauge railways. It is mostly described as an 060 wheel tank with the most disturbing face. Some holes on its smoke box door make it look like a screaming goat. Legend says that it lures trains into its clutches by mimicking the voices of other engines and crews. And when the victim doesn't realize it...
they're never found again.
That's quite a spooky explanation. But could there be a more logical one?
Could be. Maybe not. All in all, some strange things happen around these mountains. Take care.
Sounds like Jeffrey's going senile at his age.
I thought you were a decade older.
Then he's just flat out crazy. Come on, let's finish up and go home.
The little engine finished up her shunting duties and just sorted the last slate cars when...
Huh. That sounds like a radio.
Almost there.
You again?
Are you watching? I'm coming.
I have a bad feeling about this. What if that engine is...
the GOAT train? How much scotch have you been drinking?
No, seriously. Think about it. It has the ability to mimic the wolf voice and... that horrible whistle. All occurring in the same place. I'm telling you.
Come on, it's all just coincidence.
That explained that whistle.
Well... a wolf, maybe?
But there aren't any wolves out there. That's it. I'm out of here.
No, wait! Don't leave! Oh, well. I'm sure I have nothing to worry about. I'll just head home myself. Okay, calm down. Maybe it won't find me here. Yes, I'm safe. That's a relief.
That was actually pretty good.
Indeed.
I'm not buying it.
Me neither.
Well, points for trying, I guess.
I love it.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Byron, you're next.
All right. But be warned that what you're about to hear could, no, will scar you for life. The story takes place in the Soviet Union, around 1956.
Seriously? The Soviet...
As I was saying, World War II had come to a close long ago, and the beginning of the Cold War shortly followed. The Soviet Union was trying everything to stay one step ahead of the United States when it came to technological superiority. One strange case of this power struggle happened on their railways. To get a few steps ahead with their trains, an experiment was conducted at a steel mill somewhere in Siberia. 5 brand new diesels were forced into the ultimate test. 30 days, no maintenance, no inspections, no shutdowns, no repairs, and no rest. They were given special fuel that put them to endless work.
The scientists falsely promised them a long rest after the 30-day period. A few days passed, and things seemed normal. Though something odd happened on the fourth day.
Day 4. This is Dr. Andrei Ivanov. Subject 3 has experienced significant personality changes. He's much quieter, never complains about the work, and barely pays attention to the signals. Somewhat odd behavior, which can be attributed to some side effects of the fuel.
Scared yet? No? Well, we're not even halfway through.
Day 12. Dr. Ivan Ivanov speaking. We are observing strange behavior from Subject 1. When he arrived with the freight train last night, the freight cars were visibly damaged. There were cracks around the paneling, the front hitch was loose, and some of the bolts had popped off. He didn't say anything when we asked about it. Day 20. This is Dr. Andrei Ivanov. Something has gone horribly wrong with Subjects 2 and 3. Subject 2 returned with a passenger train, but it was on fire. 15 people have burned to death, and a number of others have been rushed to hospital, suffering effects of smoke inhalation. Strangely, 2 appears to be unharmed. Subject 4 has also caught fire while pulling a freight train. This time, he wasn't as lucky. By the time emergency services arrived, he was nothing but a charred mess of scrap metal. Day 26. This is Dr. Andrei Ivanov. Subject 3 has pushed Subject 2 into the sea. The engine was idling at the harbor when 3 came out of nowhere and pushed him off the rails. As you can see, 2 appears to have found us amusing for some reason. 3 didn't say anything when asked about it. Day 30. This is Dr. Andrei Ivanov. This is it. The end of the experiment is here. Now it's time to shut these engines down and drain their tanks. Alright, Subject 3, you've lasted the 30 days?
Yes.
What?
We don't want our tanks drained.
I'm sorry, I'm not following you.
We don't want to do it.
Excuse me?
Don't want to do it.
What's going on?
The deepening of bridges, so it's not me. Un broggio di cristal o gravovam, ubietse I coche uti.
He's burning up! Douse the fire! Douse the fire!
Help! Someone help us!
Quick! Stop him!
What? So close. Nearly.
The end.
Pretty good story, Byron, but I'm not scared.
You're a steamer, Connor. You can't even relate!
Nevertheless, points for effort.
Thank you, Ryan.
My turn. Once upon a time, a railway was haunted by a scary ghost train. An engine was chased by the ghost. But it turns out she was actually lonely and needed friends. The others realized this and they all became good friends. The end.
What the hell was that?!
Do you even know the basic concept of a scary story? It's supposed to be scary.
Who would be scared of that?
Quite juvenile, if you ask me.
Sorry, Georgia, but that wasn't what we were going for.
That would only be enough to send toddlers crying under cribs.
Oh well, criticism leaves room for improvement.
And now, it's my turn. The steelworks have never been any locomotive's favorite place to be. No one liked to be around metal being cut up, melted down, or simply tossed into a pile. One such factory was located somewhere in Australia, and this is where my story begins. A steel mill was going through a large financial struggle. It was low on metal and business was drying up. Nevertheless, the locomotives kept up high spirits.
How full is your train?
Half full, and that's only half of my trucks.
It's just a slow period. You'll see. By Christmas, we'll be dwarfed by mountains of sheets and girders.
That's a hopeful way to look at it.
Indeed. Let's get back to work. Mopic isn't going to boost business.
That's the spirit. Declining customers, declining income.
Relax, sir.
Relax! Have you looked at our stores? How do you catch it? What the hell happened?
How long has it been? This is my last overhaul.
Damn it, damn it, damn it! As if a loss of profit wasn't bad enough, we don't even have enough money to patch you up.
What is it?
Oh, nothing. Walker, I've just found a solution.
What do you mean?
Can you still move?
As far as I shed? Why?
Go over there. I'm preparing you for an overhaul.
Really? An overhaul? Oh, thank you, sir. Are you sure you have the parts needed?
Just you wait. My parts are all right.
The next morning, there was a sudden boom in steel and scrap, which looked eerily similar to locomotive parts and wheels. The locomotives were so overjoyed that they forgot about Walker. All except one.
This is a big turnaround.
I hear, but something doesn't seem right. Walker's nowhere to be seen. It's like he's vanished.
Oh, don't worry, Robert. He's under overhaul.
Is it just me, or does it seem strange that Walker disappeared at the same time the spare parts came?
That is weird, but try to think the worst of it. I mean, come on, business is booming.
Whatever you say.
He's lost one.
Damn it, Chimora! You know we don't have any spare buffers! Yet?
Excuse me, sir.
After that show with you, you'll receive new buffers there.
How? You're not mad, sir?
Oh, no, my dear. We all make mistakes. Run along now. Your new buffers are waiting.
Okay, then.
The same thing happened the following morning. Chalora disappeared, and new parts arrived. Robert didn't take it with a grain of salt this time. He was really starting to worry.
Well, I don't like this, Taluk. I think something bad will happen.
What are you... Wait, don't tell me. You don't think... You're not serious, are you?
Think about it, Taluk. Locomotives disappear, and new parts appear on the shelf. There's no coincidence in that. The motor I saw in my truck looked like the one Chalora had, and he disappeared last night. Just like Walker's wheels yesterday.
Stuff and nonsense, old-timer. You tell me not to think the worst of things.
Robert's worries didn't go away. That night, he decided to stay awake in case his fears became a reality in his sleep.
Maybe Tullock's right. It's all my smoke box. For all I know, those could have been brand new parts for Walker and Chalora.
But deep down, he was still dreading the possibility that his theory was true. Things didn't get any better when he noticed that Taluk was still gone.
Taluk usually complains about whacking light. Well, I better go find him.
Taluk! Taluk! Come on! It's past closing time! Taluk?
Tolok.
Oh my god. Walker. Chora.
You were right.
Tolok! Oh my god! What did they do to you?
My wheels are gone, so are my buffers and my frame.
No. Come on, let's get you out of here. We're on the right. We'll find a new home.
Robert, it's too late for me. If you wait, you'll never get out and he'll scrap you too. Go while you still have the chance. Show the world what evil hides in these steelworks.
No, I won't leave you.
Robert, I'm already gone. It's okay. Go.
I figured you'd fail first, Robert. You always managed to put the puzzles together.
What is this? What are you doing?
Allow me to explain. Lately, we've been pretty low on steel orders. That means less money, which means no maintenance, and little work. Little work means low profit. So putting two and two together, I decided to make you and the others useful.
You're disgusting! You'll be sorry!
And you think I'm gonna let you out after seeing this much?
Go! Now!
You monsters!
Where do you think you're going? Stop them!
Robert was able to lose them quite easily, albeit wearing out his joints in the process. But the painful sight of his friends still followed him. In some ways, that pain was guilt.
Victorian age, and you let him get away. Wait, what's that noise?
Robert?
That maniac think he is, running around with loaded tankers like that?
Well, that mill isn't doing business anymore, that's for sure. We're still surveying for casualties, but one of them we managed to identify is the company's CEO.
He'll rot in hell for all I know.
We also found the remains of a steam locomotive. He appears to be the perpetrator of the explosion.
Remains? As in... Robert... I'm sorry I didn't listen sooner.
Right now, mate. I hear a heritage railway nearby is looking for a new shunter.
Yeah, right now.
The end.
Eh, it's good.
You mean... My railroad could scrap me in a time of financial need.
I like the atmosphere.
I kind of expected the scrap aspect from the start.
Must you nitpick every story, Connor?
Must you be a Gary Stew backwards, boy?
You keep that up, you're gonna be the ghost of my next story.
Connor, Cabot, that's enough. So, who's next?
You're up, Gren.
Gwen? Gwen?
You know Gwen. She's the classic silent type that never said.
Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore. While I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as of someone gently rapping, rapping at my chamber door.
"'Tis some visitor,"
I muttered,
"tapping at my chamber door, only this and nothing more."
Distinctly I remember, it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow, vainly I had sought to borrow from the book surcease of sorrow, sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here forevermore. And the silken, sad and certain rustling of each purple curtain thrilled me, filled me with fantastic horrors never felt before. So that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating,
"'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. Some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This is it, and nothing more."
Presently my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer.
"Sir,"
said I,
"Oh, madam, truly your forgiveness I implore, but the fact is I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping, tapping on the chamber door, that I scarcely shall I hold you."
Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more. Deep into that darkness peering, long I stood there, wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word,
"Lenore?"
This I whispered, and an echo murmured back the word,
"Lenore, Lenore."
Merely this, and nothing more. Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning, soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before.
"Surely,"
said I,
"surely that is something at my window lattice. Let me see then what a threat is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind and nothing more."
Open here I flung the shutter, when with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but with mien of lord or lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, perched and sat, and nothing more. Then this ebony bird beguiling my sad fancy into smiling, by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore,
"Though thy crest be shorn and shaven thou,"
I said,
"art sure no craven ghastly grim, an ancient raven wandering from the nightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on the night's Plutonian shore."
Quoth the raven,
"Nevermore."
Much I marveled this ungainly fowl to hear discourse so plainly, though its answer little meaning, little relevancy bore. For we cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet was blessed with seeing bird above his chamber door, bird or beast upon the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such a name
as nevermore. But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing farther than he uttered, not a feather than he fluttered, till I scarcely more than muttered.
Other friends have flown before, on the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before.
Then the bird said,
nevermore.
Startled at this stillness broken by reply so aptly spoken.
Doubtless,
said I.
What it utters is its only stock and store caught from some unhappy master, whom unmerciful disaster followed fast, and followed faster till his songs one burden bore, till the dirges of his heard the melancholy burden bore of never, nevermore.
But the raven still beguiling all my fancy into smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then above the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linging, fancy unto fancy, thinking what this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressing to the fowl whose fiery eyes now burned into my bosom's core. This and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining on the cushion's velvet lining that the lamplight gloated o'er, but whose velvet violet lining with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall pass nevermore. Then methought the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer, swung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkered on the tufted floor.
Wretch!
I cried.
Thy God hath let thee. By these angels he hath sent thee. Respite, respite and nepeth from thy memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh quaff this kind of nepeth and forget the lost Lenore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Prophet!
Said I.
Thing of evil to profit still, if bird or devil, whether tempter sent, or whether tempest tossed thee here ashore, desolate, yes, undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home of by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Prophet!
Said I.
Thing of evil to profit still, if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends us above, by that God we both adored, tell this soul with sour laden, if within the distant Iden it shall clasp and a sainted maiden whom the angels name Lenore, clasp a rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
Be that word of our sign of parting, bird or fiend.
I shrieked, upstarting.
Get thee back into the tempest and the night's plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie thy soul has spoken. Leave thy loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak from out my heart and take thy form from off my door.
Quoth the raven.
Nevermore.
And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, and his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming, and the lamp light o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor, and my soul from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor shall be lifted Nevermore.
Wow.
What was so scary about that? It's just about a talking raven invading someone's home.
That wasn't scary, but I had to say that was,
Gothic?
Yeah, close enough. All the same, good job, Gwen. Huh? Gwen? Hello?
Oh, classic silent Gwen.
She's a shy and quiet one, all right, but her story was intriguing. Good story, Gwen. Okay, I think all of us have gone except Ryan.
Really? You want me to participate in this juvenile activity of yours?
Ah, oh, come on.
Tell us.
Show us
please,
what you got.
Please.
All right, here we go. Are any of you familiar with the Dr. Beeching of British Railways? The man who axed multiple branch lines and laid off thousands of workers? Well, there was one line on the Great Western Division that was suspiciously closed before Dr. Beeching took charge. Strangely enough, there wasn't any historical records that the Great Western Railway has such a rail line on their map. It was almost as if nobody wanted to talk about it. If you're lucky enough, you may run into some railroad staff who tell strange occurrences during his final days of operation. A conductor reported an incident where the lights blew out after a passenger train entered a tunnel. When the train came out, the sunlight revealed that the coaches were empty. At the next station, he asked the crew about the mysterious disappearances. They were confused, saying they had no memory of stopping at the previous station. This was only one of the many events. These range from freight and passenger cars moving on their own, locomotive numbers disappearing in photographs, crank pins snapping on a specific bridge, just to name a few. All employees who witnessed these supernatural events were promptly fired. But when the reports started to become more frequent, the Great Western Railway made the decision to quietly close the line without any announcement. Sometime in the 1970s, a diesel heard talk about this line from a passenger. He got curious and decided he wanted to see it for himself. He got the chance when he was assigned on a freight train to Swindon. The junction was located up near the line, near a lonely signal box.
This must be the place.
Hold on. All set.
I didn't know you were on board with this too.
Hey, no harm in adding a little something to this job, eh?
The track conditions were atrocious, much like Penn Central. It was so overgrown that the ballast almost looked like grass. The sleepers creaked as they were about to splinter, and the rails were so rusty they looked like they were made of dirt. And yet, the abandoned branch line tracks seemed to take on this main line's locomotive weight with relatively ease.
Minutes and still forest.
That does it. We're going back. Wait, do you see that?
Yes. Lord, just look at this place.
So the legend is true.
Look, there's a siding over there.
I will just observe from here. I don't like the look of this place.
There were certainly a couple of things to write home about. For one, the station windows were boarded up, even though the lights were still on. The water tower let off a rather disgusting stench. The strangest of them all, the village seemed deserted, yet looks much better and maintained than the rail yard.
Hello? Is anyone here? Wait. No, it's just an echo.
I don't like this.
What? Are you scared of an empty yard?
Well, if you want, I can just abandon you right here.
On second thought, I suddenly want to go home.
That's what I thought.
What's that?
What's what?
That sound. It's coming from that shed over there. Sounds like someone needs help. Driver? Where'd you go? Damn it, this isn't funny! What's this? Let me go! Take me back! No!
Fired pants, they be wet right now.
First off, ew. And second, that was actually pretty scary for Ryan.
Even I can admit that.
Scary.
I only rattle like this, but I feel real dread.
Could you at least tell us what he saw?
I don't know. It might give away the mystery.
Well, I think we all know who the winner is.
Thank you, everyone. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to sleep. Good luck to the rest of you.
What perfect timing, too.
Hey, sir.
What's up?
The mess at the junction has been cleared. Visitors are free to go home.
Say up, Logs.
Oh, boy.
It's about time.
Good night.
God damn it!
I was just saying the same to you!
Your vision must be backwards, Kabod!
I just wanted to get home!
Were you all built stupid?
I could have just waited like...
what am this I is gonna be a long night.
Go,
God damn it, I'm out
of
dialogue.
You took the words right out of my mouth.
Okay, just roll the credits already.
Spooky, scary skeletons and shivers down your spine. Shrieking skulls will shock your soul, seal your doom tonight. Spooky, scary skeletons speak with such a screech. You'll shake and shudder in surprise when you hear these zombies shriek.
We're so sorry, skeletons, you're so misunderstood. You only want to socialize,
but I don't think we should.
Cause spooky, scary skeletons shout startling, shrilly screams. They'll sneak from their sarcophagus and just won't leave you.
Hee hee.